Welcome to the Night of the Proms, a curiously European institution. Tonight, 18,000 Germans will sing Land of Hope and Glory, and a status quo classic will be performed in Italian by an operatic star on a mobile platform. Amongst it all, a sprinkling of rock and pop legends will play medleys of their greatest hits. Deep in the backstage labyrinth, one such band prepares for their 13 minutes in the limelight. They are eagerly anticipated.
Right, final time to leave. Deep breathing.
OMD sold millions of records across Europe, with number ones in virtually every territory. But it's been 17 years since they last played together.
Have you seen his shoes? Then there's my clown shoes. That's a shoe, that's a toothpick.
They missed their cue.
On the surface, it seems a strange choice for a comeback gig. One of the most innovative, influential, and intellectual electronic bands of the 80s will be playing their hits backed by a full orchestra and choir. But it's typical behaviour for Andy McCluskey and Paul Humphreys. The challenge of doing something new and unexpected has always been difficult to resist. This latest musical experiment is just the start of a whole new chapter for OMD. Andy and Paul plan to write new material, record a new album, and embark on a headline tour of their own. Differences that sent them in opposite directions two decades ago have been put aside. The stage is set for a reunion that has been long overdue.
Sempre regina, per io il tuo re. were two kids from a nondescript suburb of Liverpool, both working class, both with no money, who had a hobby that was trying to emulate German imported records that even our best friends thought were utterly awful.
Orchestral Manoeuvres in the Dark. A hobby that became an adventurous, thoughtful, and fearless ongoing musical experiment. An experimental band that had worldwide smash hit singles and albums and took to writing the poppiest of classic pop songs. The internationally successful pop group that got sick of the commercial treadmill and sick of each other. 17 years later, it's all back on, to the delight of the seemingly invisible masses of hardcore fans. The classic lineup of Paul Humphreys, Andy McCluskey, Mal Holmes, and Martin Cooper plan to tour and record once more.
There is a change in the musical environment where what we used to do has, for various reasons, become perceived as being valuable again and of interest. And so that gives you the feeling that there's a possibility that you could do something again that would interest people.
It's been quite a number of years since I've even considered being in OMD. I mean, I think Andy finished in 95 around that time. So it's really is revisiting my past in a big way.
In some respects, as is often in the case in life, something comes to an end and isn't resolved to your satisfaction, is left somewhat hanging, and whilst it wasn't awful and grim, there was a little bit of unfinished business and unpleasant air left hanging, so it would be nice to maybe just go and tidy that up and rebuild a few bridges and things.
I'm excited by it, I have to say, you know, and the thought about us going on stage together as well is an exciting thing. We grew up on stage.
Since the split, Andy and Paul have both done the family thing, and they've each carved out very different musical careers. Andy's adventures in the world of manufactured pop, perhaps the more conspicuous. Atomic Kitten star shone brightly thanks to the songwriting skills of McCluskey, the wise old man of the music biz.
Having spent the last 9 years writing for and helping other people, which has been very interesting, there's been an element of an old dog learning new tricks, which I wouldn't have done had I kept within the parameters of trying to do Orchestral Manoeuvres in the Dark. But also I realised that I didn't want to do that anymore. I didn't want to work for and with other people. I would like to go back to doing something for me again. And having spent 9 years not doing it, there's a hunger and an interest again in doing it.
And while Andy was cajoling the kittens towards the top of the charts, Paul was hard at work with his partner Claudia Brooken in their London recording studio. The result of years of labour is a new album and a tour to be fitted in before OMD 2007 kicks in.
I've played a few gigs recently with my new band, 1-2, and it was fantastic, you know, just to get on stage. But having been on stage playing so many gigs with Andy, it did occur to me that I looked over to the right and it was Claudia singing and not Andy, you know, and I made this click because I'm so used to seeing Andy to my right, you know, and I had this sort of double take.
She dances madly.
No, I wouldn't let her.
When we initially had the idea 9 months ago now that we might start up working together again, the initial idea was so enticing and so positive that I think we were blinded by the flash of the light. And obviously you don't stop and think about the reality of making it happen. And I think that probably everybody involved, even though it's only just begun, is already starting to realise that making the dream into a reality can be a bit of a logistics nightmare.
I mean, the thing about Andy and I is we're both quite strong sort of personalities, and we both have a very sort of strong idea of what we should be doing. And when those ideas run parallel of what we should be doing, then that's always been the best of OMD. And when one of us has veered off, it's not quite worked.
Paul and I are very different people. We're no longer the teenagers or the early 20s who had no money, lived at home, didn't have wives or children or mortgages or worried about our futures. So all of those things are inevitably going to affect how we come to this.
The boys grew up not far from each other on Merseyside. Wirral is politely suburban compared to the rough and tumble of the big city across the water.
I've known Andy since we were at primary school together.
They were a school year apart, and friendship and collaboration were some way off.
First ever memory of Paul Humphrey's was him being made to stand on stage at lunchtime in junior school, obviously having done something considered incorrect by the teachers. And I seem to recall that some unpleasant child or children were actually making some cutting remark to him about the fact that his father had passed away. And I seem to remember feeling, I don't know if I intervened, I probably didn't, but I do remember that was the first memory of him and feeling somewhat sorry for him and horrified at the position he found himself in.
You couldn't live that close to Liverpool without wanting to be in a band. The teenage Andy and Paul were no exception.
I thought about the idea of drums but couldn't afford a drum kit. I tried guitar and it hurt my fingers. It was far too complicated. So bass seemed the logical middle ground. Got everybody on my 16th birthday to give me money and went down to the local second-hand shop in Birkenhead and bought the only bass they had in that I could afford, which happened to be a left-handed bass. Hence I learned to play bass guitar upside down, even though I'm right-handed.
I used to see him walking around our town with a bass over his shoulder, and I was kind of involved with this other band, really just helping them. I couldn't play at all. I was more their techie than musician. You know? And so that was the first time I became aware of Andy, because I knew this band needed a bass player. And so I remember we got brave enough one day and we went round and knocked on his door.
But the band's electronics expert and newly appointed bass player soon began meeting up away from rehearsals. What brought them together at Paul's mum's house was a shared passion for the German band Kraftwerk, an unusual influence for members of a student rock band.
I think Paul and I started to realise that we had a little bit more in common with our musical influences than the other guys in the band.
Very much a rock band format, really. And at the end of band rehearsals, we used to sort of stay behind sometimes and just do our sort of experiments. And our experiments sort of started to get honed up, and then we started to sort of introduce our experiments into this rock format, which was fairly interesting, but ultimately failed.
We eventually saw the light that there was a possibility that there were some bits of technology, predominantly a tape recorder, actually, that we could have access to, whereby we could do it the way we'd always envisaged it, and we didn't need the live drums and the lead guitar. And that's when the light went on and we thought, right, we're going to do it the way we always kind of liked 3.5, 4 years ago when we were 16. And that's when we started Orchestral Manoeuvres in the Dark.
In the late 70s, there was only one place in Liverpool that a new band could get an audience. Roger Eagles, now legendary Eric's, played host to the likes of Joy Division, The Teardrop Explodes, and Echo and the Bunnymen. Andy and Paul felt right at home.
Orchestral Manoeuvres in the Dark was only conceived to do one concert. It was a dare. we were finally going to do it our way. And we were going to do one concert, if only to prove that we could.
We weren't a studio sort of techno band, you know, where we just sort of played. I mean, there was an element of that, to us, sort of the Boffins experimenting, you know. But really, we started on stage. We were playing on stage before we could make records, and we learnt our trade on stage, and we loved to play on stage.
So this is Eric's, because it's black and red. Look, the door's red, that's black, the ceiling's black. But this just doesn't look at all. This is the lower bar area, Paul, right? Because it goes up. You see, there was a wall there, the bar was here, and it goes up. This is the bit that used to flood.
So the stage would have been over there?
Yeah,
then.
The stage is there. This is the bit that used to flood.
Flood, that's
where
right, the toilets used to overflow.
Lovely.
Nice.
So, yeah, this has got to be the old dressing room, hasn't it?
It is, isn't it? Yeah. This is the dressing room when it first opened, that you have to walk out of here and through the audience,
because
the stage is through that wall.
Exactly. But they never had access, did they?
No, you have to go through the audience and back in. And this is the place where I can remember sitting in here when we had to cut the piece out of the tape because we didn't have the synthesizer to play dancing, because we never owned a synth in the others, and we borrowed one that you went, it doesn't make that noise, and we're like...
Okay, that has to go. We just spooled it onto the floor.
This was the dressing room.
Wow, God.
We would have used this dressing room probably half a dozen times. And the last time we used it, I remember thinking we finally arrived, because we didn't get paid, but Roger Eagle gave us 6 bottles of beer.
Yeah.
And I thought...
And we thought, rizzled.
We're on the way. Yeah. Because we started here playing Thursday evenings that were free for members. And it was just a showcase, really, for local bands. So we played here several Thursdays.
Which was before, the free night. Yeah.
Before we were elevated to the giddy heights of not being on a Thursday, where people actually had to pay to get in.
To get in, yeah.
And, yeah, I remember thinking, hey, we must be doing something right. We've got some beer.
From the very first gig, Andy and Paul set out to distort people's perceptions of what electronic music was all about. The chief weapon was their live act.
The conscious decision was the determination to try to get something that was strong visually, to try and take onto the stage some of the things that we so cherished that were created by Peter Saville in particular in the sleeve artwork. But the unconscious thing was a decision right from the very early days, I think probably made by myself, that being aware that there was a perception that electronic music was a bit boring and a bit nerdy and a bit cold and a bit over-intellectual, that in my own clumsy way I was trying to imbue it with some physical energy to prove that it wasn't boring.
If you're all going to sit there, you all deserve to die of boredom.
Andy's dancing in particular, bordering dangerously on the uncoordinated, couldn't have been further removed from the shot dummy image of their German heroes.
Kraftwerk sort of stand there po-faced with their machines, and we thought, well, there's no point in us doing that. And besides, we liked to sort of dance and bop around, and we also liked to play. I mean, there's a lot of bands that just let their machines do the talking, you know, and do the playing. And you're just kind of starting and stopping machines. For us, the love of playing was actually, in a very traditional band sense, in a way, even though we weren't a traditional band, it was, in a way, rock bands play. We wanted to play our instruments with each other and create a vibe and an atmosphere that would be different every night, depending on how we played. But that was the fun of it, really, and the challenge of it, because none of us are really great musicians. So in that sense, it was a challenge that we all really enjoyed. Can we do it? This song is even more complicated than the one before. Can we play this live?
Somebody handing me a copy of ZZ Top's autobiography and pointing me to a page where they lay the blame or the credit for their rocking guitar swinging dance move in all their sort of electro song videos of the mid 80s at my door, because they had done an old grey whistle test with us in 1980 and been immensely impressed with our band. I'd like to say that the feeling was reciprocated, but we were a bunch of spiky 20-year-olds who thought they were a bunch of middle-aged beardy has-beens and treated them with disdain, to be honest.
Okay, the mixing area is right here, isn't it?
Yeah.
And then the stage will be here.
So this was the stage.
I remember this as being much bigger.
I remember it being so much bigger, God almighty.
I don't remember the scene being so low.
Oh, yeah.
Do you remember that?
Yeah, because I mean...
I just remember it as being a...
The stage was only...
Well, it wasn't very high, the stage.
Stage was only a foot high, because you couldn't get it any higher. I mean, look, here.
When you stood on the stage here...
You'd be close to these pillars.
And they had lamps up there. I mean, what is that? I mean, I'm reaching up there, that's about, what, 9 feet?
Yeah.
So you had 8 feet clearance to get your lamps in. So you'd stand here with a par lamp, like there,
yeah,
on your head.
I know, I remember
boiling.
The heat from them.
Yeah. October 78, we played here, because this was always the main stage.
Yeah.
Supporting Joy Division, I think, our first gig, wasn't
it?
Yeah,
it was.
I don't think I would have done any pogo. Maybe that's why I developed the windmill dance, because any pogo in, you would have done your brains in. The OMD gig, there was, oh, what, 30 people here? Mostly friends, and even they didn't clap. Yeah. It was like, yeah,
how unsolidaric was that?
Yeah. So no wonder we thought we didn't have a hope as a career.
Our friends didn't like our music either, you know.
I was standing here. Don't remember what gig I was at. I was standing here. Elvis Costello was standing in front of me,
really?
And somebody came up and said, Keith Moon out of the Who's died. I remember that moment.
Really?
Leaning on this pillar behind Elvis Costello. I don't remember who was on stage, but I remember that.
Wow, amazing.
Yeah.
God, I feel so bloody ancient.
It's not good. Not good for a reunion, this. I'm feeling really antique.
We weren't great musicians. We hadn't had any kind of formal training at all. We were kind of teaching ourselves. And I think in some ways we wanted to run before we could walk. We wanted to write songs before we could play our instruments or know how to write songs. And so our way of arriving at something that was close to a song or could be called a song or be palatable as a song was to kind of combine all our, make as many mad noises as we could and give it a form. And that was we called that a song, you know. During those experiments, we wrote Electricity. It must have been 16, 17. It was us emulating Kraftwerk. It started out as emulating Kraftwerk.
Electricity being a tribute to Kraftwerk is a nice way of putting a complete rip-off of Radioactivity. Manually. We didn't have MIDI and we didn't have a sequencer. It wasn't played from a drum machine. we were completely inspired by them. And when we finally got some keyboards that would actually play recognisable musical notes, as opposed to the collection of junk that we'd accumulated and built ourselves that just made random noises, it was essentially the first song we ever wrote.
So I'd been playing bass guitar sort of 3.5 years by then, and I was adequate. I could hit it hard like that. Don't ask me to play anything more complicated than that.
We sounded like we did, basically because we had no money. So we had to just buy second-hand, really rubbishy sounding instruments. Or I made them myself with my electronics knowledge.
SIP, Selma Electronic Piano, which is the melody. Which Paul bought from a friend of mine at school for £25. And it was a plucked instrument. It wasn't so much a piano. It actually had a series of little metal bars, like a giant kalimba, and it plucked these little bars that each had pickups on them. So that's the, and of course the distinctive OMD cheesy box Jaguar organ.
It was unconsciously informed by the only instruments we had to hand and our own personalities and abilities. So it was a sort of slightly frantic, punky, simplistic teenage response to radioactivity, which in itself created its own identity.
Nasty little synth. Another nasty little synth. But the two of them together are phasing in and out, and again, you stick tons of reverb and echo on it, and it sounds glorious. Don't realise it's such a nasty little Rolf Harris stylophone sound.
At his Liverpool recording studio, Andy McCluskey has been reunited with some old friends. The original 2-inch master recordings of their early work. Every melody, chord, drumbeat and rhythm can now be digitally archived. It'll mean that despite the loss of the machines that they used to use, OMD 2007 will sound more authentic than ever. But it's a race against time. The music may still sound fresh, but the tapes are disintegrating.
Well, there was a time during the 80s when there was more and more demand on the tape and the signal-to-noise ratio that they would have to have. And in improving the performance of the tapes, they started using different substances. The adhesive that they were using actually starts to absorb water over time. So when you then load it on a machine 20 years later, it all falls to pieces. Since been discovered that by slowly baking it, the water comes out of the adhesive, and it means that you can have chance to transfer it before it's ruined again. But you get about another month or so's life out of it before you would then need to do it again.
Already saved and digitally stored are the contents of OMD's first album. It was a milestone that neither Andy or Paul ever expected to reach.
We didn't think that anybody would be interested in signing OMD. That was the thing. We thought our music was just too weird and experimental for anyone to be interested in us. So we were just doing it really for ourselves, and we were enjoying going playing it live, and we could see some people were enjoying it, but we just thought we were a bit too weird.
We did grab every opportunity that came our way, but we never saw them as stepping stones towards a career. We just saw them as an opportunity, an open door. Well, hey. Let's have it. We'll take it.
Their attempts not to take the world by storm were coordinated from their local pub, handily situated right next door to their compact and bijou office. Red
frame, white light. I remember remember Andy calling Sounds once, and they said, because we wanted to get in the gig guide at Sounds, and I remember Andy saying on the phone from the telephone box, which was our office, you know, 6323003. Andy came off the phone laughing because he said, you know what the guy said to me? He said, you'll never get anywhere with a band name like Orchestral Manoeuvres in the Dark. And we thought he was right, really, because it was just such an odd... It was an odd name, our music was odd. And it really wasn't until we got involved with Factory Records that Tony Wilson said to us, you know, this isn't weird experiments, this is pop music. This is modern pop music.
And I believe the story goes that he wasn't particularly impressed or interested.
It turned out that his wife had been playing electricity in the car to Tony all the time. And she kept saying to Tony, you've got to sign these guys, they're great, you've got to sign them, they're great. Until I think she convinced Tony to give us a punt.
He said, you know, we're only a small label, we can't get you to where you should be. And we were like, well, where should we be? Oh, on a big label. Making hit singles, you're a pop group, which of course was deeply offensive to us because we were a German-influenced experimental duo. He sent out our first single on Factory Records, Electricity, with Almost on the B-side, to all the major labels. And again, fortunately, Carol Wilson had just been given a new company, a subsidiary of Virgin called Dindisc, and heard our single and asked to come and see us. We didn't have any gigs. We didn't play gigs very often. She came to see us in Paul's mum's back room and sat on the sofa. And we played our entire collection of songs, which was probably six, maximum seven. And she followed us around a bit more, and we played in Blackpool with Joy Division and Certain Ratio. She missed the gig. She was going on holiday to Scotland, but she popped in, said, oh, you've been on stage, have you? Well, anyway, never mind. Read this on the way home, and handed us a contract offer. It was bonkers. She was off her trolley. We weren't going to sell records. We were going to take her money and build a studio.
Well, we're outside what used to be our studio at the Grampian Street, and we are, what, 300 yards from Eric's, just round the corner. We were up on the first floor. We used to sit and people watch out that window, didn't we?
We did, yeah. When we said skive off work, just people watch.
We sell them.
If somebody was going to give you £30,000, you should go and blow it all, and all you'd have to show for it was a couple of 2-inch reels of tape. It's not that. Give us the money, we'll build a studio, and when we don't sell any records and you drop us, at least we'll have a studio. So that was what we did.
The name, the Gramophone Suite, may suggest a highly geared, high-tech, luxurious recording studio, but the reality was very different.
This was the back of two music shops that were on the other side, Hesse's and Curly Music, and Curly Music rented us the first floor for the princely sum of £25 a week, a half of the first floor. We couldn't afford £50 a week. And we were there for 4 years, and we wrote and recorded our first four albums up there.
Our budgeting for failure ultimately turned out for the next few years to be a bonus that we hadn't anticipated and that perhaps, you know, other bands wouldn't have had. We needed a space to write. We needed technology. We needed a desk and a tape machine because, for the most part, there was only two of us there.
I do remember going in with Paul one time and a mouse shot up his trouser leg.
It did, and it lodged itself right by a, you know, very delicate plate. And so I had to whip my pants off.
I was running around to batter it to death with a shovel.
Borrowed a shovel, battered it, poor little thing to death. How awful! I should have kept it as a pet, really.
Well, once it had tasted blood, you know, it was gonna.
I was just, you know, took it personally that it decided to go so close to where it shouldn't be. You know,
well hard is our Paul. Well hard.
Wow.
I tell you, the only thing I recognise is the view.
Yeah, that hasn't changed much. This is... How much would it have cost us to make it look like this?
We should have. We spent all those years in here.
We didn't have the money.
We didn't have the money, did we?
This is unbelievable.
It's so clean.
And these
clean.
Beams?
Yeah, these are the same. The ties on the beams and the view from the window. That the rest and of it, you wouldn't know you were in the same room.
So the control room was?
The control room was over in that corner. When we used to work together so closely as we did in the early days, we never analysed it. You don't analyse it. It just functions and you get on with it. Obviously, when we stopped working together, that was when I analysed it and perhaps started to believe that the differences in the two personalities actually created a sum that was greater than the two individual parts together. And I think that I was very much the driver and the instigator and the editor and arranger. And Paul was generally the more intuitive creator who would just find sounds, find chords, find melodic ideas, throw them out at me, and I would pick and choose and edit and direct. And we very much, you know, we had our places in the control room. I was behind the desk operating the machine and the faders, and he was playing the instruments, and I would be going, oh, I like that, don't like that. What about na 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 na? Yeah, that one. Put that one next and then change the fourth chord to something, I don't know what, you know. And we would just be banging off each other. Paul would do the majority of the playing and I would be doing the directing and the picking and the choosing.
And this was the control room. This was the room where Souvenir was written, yeah. And all of Architecture and Morality and most of Organisation and Dazzle Ships. This was the room where we wrote and did the demos.
Yeah, that's right. We had all this space, but really we spent nearly all of our time in there because that's where all the machines were. You know, out there we did the vocals and some drums and stuff like that, yeah. But really it was just in the small space where we did everything.
I don't know, they may have taken that wall out. It's hard to know exactly how, I don't remember how big it was, but judging on the fact that everything we've seen is smaller than we remember it.
Maybe it was about this big.
It was about this big. You, me,
these
and
enormous speaker.
No wonder we're deaf.
What?
Yeah. The control room, what's left of it.
Hiding away in the obscurity of the gramophone suite was not an option as far as their record company was concerned. Andy and Paul's lives were beginning to change.
It was the fact that we did make an album, that we did do our own headline tour, that hundreds and hundreds of people turned up, we got asked for autographs, we went on television, and then in May 1980, our third single was a hit single. That's when I think we went, Jesus, we might actually get away with this. It worries me this kind of thing. How do you hope to live alone? And I can buy your wicked eyes.
So were these expensive when you born?
Yeah. £7.76 for 36 weeks from my mother's mail order catalogue. I was on the dole at the time, it was expensive. It was on £14 a week. As we acquired something, obviously it informed the palette that we could use, quite simply. We discovered another colour, and that would lead us off into a whole new area. So the early synthesizers with their monophonic sound, played by one finger, that was the simple sound of the band. Right, let's see if I can remember how to do this. Repeat. Traveller doesn't work. Sustain. Did messages all by hand, holding it down. And just shifting the octaves up and down.
physical challenge took us ages. Yeah. You had to turn the knob like this. Yeah. It wasn't playing.
No.
It was knob turning, you know, at a certain time, you know. And trying to get it to catch the note as it went through was just took us, oh, it took us forever. And every day you send me more. It makes two verses of the plan on yours. To be sure, I don't forget.
We laid down messages for about 4 or 5 minutes, just like that. And if you isolate the original sequence, well, it's not a sequencer, it's just a synth on repeat with selecting the octave, you can hear the glitches where we got it at the wrong time, but we just had to go with it because it took us about an hour just to get 1 5-minute piece that we could live with. And Messages is in G sharp, which is not a key we would normally choose to use, but the problem we later discovered when we came to play it, having spent an hour recording it, was that we were holding G down, but the pitch wheel was a semitone too high, so we laid down the whole damn thing a semitone too high. It should have been down there, but for some reason we had it, so we just shifted the whole thing into G sharp because we couldn't be bothered to go and record it again for another hour in the lower key. But that's how Messages was done.
It's very easy to sound bland now because everyone has access to the same sounds. Whereas at least in those days, we were making our own. We were making do with what we had and trying to make something interesting with these very odd, quirky instruments that we had at our disposal.
A dingy Liverpool basement is to be the setting for a milestone in the story of OMD.
It's great rehearsing in basements. You have to come and run upstairs to make phone calls.
The band will be whole again for the first time in nearly 20 years. Mal Holmes is once again fit enough to keep a beat after major heart surgery in 2005. And Martin Cooper, who may have thought his touring days were over when he became a professional artist, is finding out just how much keyboard technology has moved on.
Trying to recreate the 80s, it's like the 70s never went away.
Exactly.
So I don't electrocute myself on camera. That might be quite a shot, actually, won't it? I better unplug it. Don't point that at me. I'm a bad move.
Last time the four of us played together was Pasadena Rose Bowl, playing with Depeche Mode in Los Angeles. Years and 90,000 people ago, you know, little room with just us and you guys.
All right, can you just play Messages from the top? Just make sure everybody's okay with the amount of sequencer and bass and blah, 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 and their own keyboards.
Yeah.
And then if everybody isn't, we'll stop. If everybody's okay, we'll go as far as we deal till we fall off the end. Now, have you all got enough bass?
Actually. Yeah, I thought Mal and Andy were grooving together. You know, the rhythm section's got a gel in a band, otherwise the band is only as good as its rhythm section. And so Andy and Mal really gelled, I thought.
The weirdest thing for me was just the singing. The first time I actually open my mouth and hear it coming through the speaker, which I haven't done. I've been playing the bass through the speaker, I'm used to that, but I wasn't used to singing live again.
Just looking around, watching, you know, there's Mal on drums, and there's Mark playing the keys, and there's Andy playing bass and singing, and I'm with everyone. It was a bit strange, but lovely at the same time. It was kind of like a sort of family reunion in a way.
It's the old cliche, you know, the riding the bike cliche. It just comes back to you, and it really does.
I don't know. I think basically, I mean, we have to decide.
It's one of those things that's like when you play it every night, you know, I sing it four times, we go around two more times, and then we stop. Yeah, yeah. But we'll just have to get used to it.
We'll just get used to it, yeah, we know what we're
going
to.
It's, that's true. Hey!
I thought it sounded great.
Well, it was.
It wasn't crap.
For the first time in 17 years, that was fairly reassuring, actually.
It was, actually, yeah.
It's all downhill from now.
Thanks, on.
Whether they wanted it or not, Orchestral Manoeuvres in the Dark were now a success. Andy and Paul retreated to the gramophone suite and emerged with a second album, Organization. Darker, deeper, more thoughtful than the first. Influenced by the bands around them, like Joy Division. Breathing life into their machines, they even gave the local oil refinery a soul.
It's early, this field remains stand alone.
The only single release from the album was an international smash hit. But Enola Gay was an explosive choice in more ways than one.
It was the first single we released that was just written by one of us. Our manager at the time, Paul Collister, threatened to resign if Enola Gay was released because he thought it was a piece of pop crap, a sellout cop-out, and was nothing to do with the experimental and artistic type of music that we'd been doing previously. So he was horrified. Paul didn't get it.
Also, what I didn't realise was the organ is playing it as well. And all three together. And then you just ram that down the echo and the reverb and the harmonizer and every effect, and suddenly it gets 10 times bigger. I wrote this song actually at Paul's house. I don't know where he was. I suspect he may have actually been working at the swimming pool where he had to be a hod carrier because to keep his dole money, he had to go and do some local community work. Paul Humphrey's carrying a hod must have been quite a sight actually when he was 18, 19 years old. But it was, I wrote this on my own in Paul's house. So I assume he was out, his mother was at work, and I'd been given the keys and was allowed in because we had all the equipment in his back room then at the time. And this song was actually written before our first album was released, but it just didn't quite make it onto the album. All the others had been written sometime previously.
The song proved troublesome to record. Andy wasn't happy with his initial attempts at the vocal, and the drum machine patterns were changed at the last minute. Some problems, however, he was happy to let pass.
In the middle eight, it was like, we don't know what to do. So if in doubt, drop it out. That was our thing. If in doubt, just play it. And so the middle eight, basically, we couldn't come up with a new part, so we just kind of went, boom, and we put a big reverb on. Boom. And then Malcolm does his drum fill too early. This is the classic climb out of the middle eight. Malcolm does his drum fill too early. So he goes... So we made it. So we made the cock up into a part. We put the bell tree in it. So his screw up actually gave us another part. Like, what? Zing! Bang! Great. Well, we'll keep that. That was a mistake, which we kept.
In just 4 weeks, Andy and Paul are due to begin their run with the Nokia Night of the Proms. Today, they rehearse with a full orchestra for the first time. Understandably nervous, Andy is also worried about his voice.
Second chin.
All three of them.
There's a third one? God. Now I'm sure my hand.
This is actually the interesting bit. It's just frustrating for me. These are the days when I wish I wasn't the singer, because I'm a bit of a problem with my voice. But in half an hour, I'll find out. Either I'll be... talking the words and hoping the orchestra rehearse anyway, or I'll be singing them. I don't know what's going to happen. We'll see.
Just a few firsts today, which always makes you a bit nervous. We've got these weird in-ear things where we have sound piped into our ears instead of the rock and roll monitor thing, so that's making me a bit nervous. A bit like playing underwater, really, but with perfect sound. Which is a bit odd, but should be good fun.
Before the full orchestra arrive, there's a run-through with just the backing singers and the band.
Hi.
Hi.
Andy.
Hi, Marilyn.
Hello again. Hello again. Have you had a chance to listen to any of these songs?
Time is tight. Everyone apart from Andy and Paul have another show to do tonight.
All the way.
It's time for the full orchestra to take their places on stage. A 17-year gap between performances. But as the rehearsal draws to a close, it appears that it's all coming back to Andy and Paul.
Some of those top notes, and I was that close to them, but yeah. They were just breaking off. Well, we survived. But God, we're going to have to be better in 4 weeks' time.
Yeah, but we will be. So we've got 4 weeks to practice.
I'm getting my voice sorted out. That was so annoying.
It certainly made a difference when the orchestra arrived, didn't it?
It is. Like when the orchestra turns up, it's kind of like all of a sudden all the colours fitted in. Especially with us, because we specifically requested the arranger to really use the orchestra so that the band is really just playing like the skeleton in the background. And the orchestra is like, you know, 70-80% of it. So when the orchestra were there, how fast do they learn that stuff? And the three girls who didn't really know the songs until this morning. So, you know, I was singing along and all of a sudden I could hear these girls singing. I'm like, God, they've learned the song. So, yeah, we'll be good.
Well, the OMD songs from my era, I know inside out and I can play in my sleep. These,
apart from when I come over and put you up in Souvenir.
In Souvenir, yeah, I know. I totally lost the plot when you put me up. Yeah, but yes, it's a bit odd playing them, but it's kind of fun to play them as well. And it's always fun to play new stuff, you know, whether it's your own new stuff or someone else's. So I don't mind it at all. I see it as a challenge, really. Learning a new song is always a challenge.
I want to ask you, Andy, as well, you couldn't help yourself, could you? There was a couple of windmill moments there, weren't there?
but I restrained myself in Maid of Orleans. Maid of Orleans is going to be the acid test. That was dancing. I think I was dancing at the end of the 70s, which is OK. That's the way I think I can dance. I mean, I maybe want to see this played back before I go on stage, actually, so I can...
Decide if you want to do that or not.
Decide if I want to look that stupid. I don't know.
My view is, it's all or nothing.
No.
All or nothing.
There's
no halfway house when you dance.
No, surely there's got to be some way that's sort of like entertaining and lively, but isn't excruciatingly embarrassing. Surely? No? Oh, shit.
In 1981, Enola Gay had been an international smash hit, and the world was waiting for an album to follow the critically acclaimed organisation. OMD may have made it, but the best was yet to come.
It started with this kind of like synth pop garage punky sound. We'd gone into a more kind of gothic, slightly Joy Division influenced, if I'm honest, sound on the second album, which was darker, and come out into this, what in hindsight seems a logical extension, which is the Architecture Morality album.
I think a lot of the sort of synth
pop elements came from Kraftwerk, and I think a lot of the melancholia came from Eno, Brian Eno, his influences. And I think that was, in those days, I think it was a sort of a real merge of those two influences, because we love Eno's textures and atmospheres, which we're listening to a lot at the time.
The title was suggested to us by Martha Ladley, who was Peter Saville, our sleeve designer's girlfriend at the time. She was also one of the two Marthas in Martha and the Muffins, who were also on Dindisc. She had, I assume she'd read the book by David Watkins, Morality and Architecture, and we nicked it off her. I think she was going to write a song, and we nicked it off her. And we liked it because I think we saw it as a metaphor for what we did. We had the architecture, the technology, the drum machines, the rigid playing, the attempt to break out of the box by doing specifically crafted sounds, and yet the inherent morality, the organic, the human, the emotional touch, which we just naturally brought. You know, we were not trying to be Kraftwerk. We were not writing songs about robots in a robotic way. We would write a song about something that might be a piece of technology, or an oil refinery, or a telephone box, but we would somehow manage to imbue it or distill out of it something emotional. So it was a nice, pretentious title with big words, architecture and morality, that appealed to two 21-year-olds as a statement for describe your music in three words, architecture and morality.
The album sold over 3 million copies and spawned a string of hits. Barely into their 20s, Andy and Paul were at the top of their game.
We were on a roll then, and we were loving everything we were doing. And we also felt, we had a bit of sort of arrogance about us as well. We felt we were sort of infallible in a way, because everything we kept doing, it kept getting better and better, and it kept becoming more and more successful.
I think there probably came a point in the early 80s where the relationship was at its optimum. We were enjoying the creative part, we were enjoying the success, we were enjoying the trappings that success brought of going on telly and having gold albums and getting a bit of money. There were occasions when we were about to go on stage in front of several thousand people or go and do a TV show in front of several million people, where we would catch a glance at each other and we'd, you know, we'd give ourselves that knowing look of like, how the hell did we get here? Wow.
The first single release set the trend with international chart success, but Souvenir, written by Paul Humphreys alone, was not Andy McCluskey's first choice.
Do you know, it seems unbelievable and presumably petty and pathetic in hindsight that I had an issue over Souvenir.
Some songs you can labour over and work on for months to try to perfect it, and some songs just arrive, and that song just arrived. It's my direction, it's my proposal. It's so hard, it's
leading me astray. I thought it was too pastoral and sweet. It wasn't my sort of song.
When I'd written it, it was almost like it had always been there. It had always been written, if you know what I mean. It's hard to describe.
It seemed a radically different song to me, and it bothered me intensely. And I suspect that Paul thought I had an issue with it as a sort of personal revenge for knowing that he had an issue with Enola Gay being released. Of course, 6 months, 9 months later, and it wasn't just because it was a monster hit, I got it. I realised that it was a beautiful, beautiful piece of ethereal melody.
The way the whole song arrived was that Dave Hughes, who used to be in Dalek, I Love You, and had a brief spell in OMD, did a choral session at Amazon Studios in Liverpool, and he got this choir to sing lots of different notes. And he came knocking on the door one day and said, I've got all these tapes of all these single note choirs, but I don't have the facility to be able to kind of do anything with them. He said, how about I share these choir notes with you? If you can help me do all the loops, and we'll both have a copy of these choir loops each. So I said, okay, that's a deal. And then we did these loops, and I just put them onto 16 tracks of our 16-track tape, each track a different note. And I kind of worked out what all the notes were, and I marked up the desk for each note. And then I was just this sort of contortionist, and I'd push up the faders, making chords with these single notes. And about the first pattern I did was the Souvenir pattern.
And when it's isolated on its own, you can really hear that it's wobbling and fluttering and... clicks and bangs.
But I think that's why Souvenir sounds the way it does, because when you play a choral sound on a keyboard, when you take your fingers off, really the notes stop, unless you do some adjustments to it. But with that, the chords melted because it actually took a physical time to push the faders up and bring them down. And so the chords were just melting across each other, which I wouldn't have played it like that on a keyboard. I would have just done block chords, and it wouldn't have had... I think that's part of the beauty of Souvenir, is just the sort of melt of choral effects with the way the, and then the keyboard melody over the top of this sort of swirling choral thing, which makes the atmosphere, I think. So I think that was a definite case of the technology. If we'd had the technology, it probably wouldn't have been as good.
This, which is called Plink, which is, if you see the multi-track, it's called Paul's Plink Song. That's the plink. And then there's the chord. But with no repeat on it. In the mix. But bone dry and horrible on its own. And the virtuoso performance from Mr. McCluskey, the only thing he gets to do, of course, is this. This is the all I did. Play the bass. And I just thought this was really, really middle of the road Muzak bass player. And I was like,
yeah.
I feel like I'm accompanying a bloody, you know, jazz band at a social club, you know. Bum, bum, bum. I had as been historically recorded, I had a lot of problem with this song. I thought it was really, really middle of the road, a bit wet, a bit not very cool. And so I really tried hard to introduce some new elements to it, which fortunately got edited out. I put a synth in it.
Souvenir was not only written by Paul Humphreys, but he also performed the lead vocal, ensuring that the shy one would have to venture out from behind his keyboards and into the limelight.
Of course, you've got the delights of Mr. Humphreys singing on his own for the first time, which when Moby did a remix of it, he just used one vocal. And even by his own admission, Paul Humphreys said it made your fillings fall out. He's a considerably improved singer than he was when he was 21 years old.
It's my direction. It's my proposal. It's so hard.
And again.
It's leading me astray. It's my...
You can hear more of his headphones than of him.
It's my direction. It's my proposal. It's so hard. It's leading me...
That's the double track. But when the two of them get together, like the small synths, the difference in the tuning actually creates a harmonic which actually makes it a lot sweeter to listen to. So it pulled, you know, it was double tracked.
Whatever the success enjoyed by OMD in the UK, it was becoming apparent that the group were gaining an even bigger following throughout the rest of Europe. Every album did better than the last, and every tour had to take in more dates in more countries. Travelling was a strange mix of excitement, inspiration, boredom, and exhaustion, and the odd life-changing moment.
We were playing at a venue called the Zecher Club in Bochum in Germany in 1982. And Malcolm and Martin came backstage just before we went on stage to announce, "You'll never guess who's in the audience." Kraftwerk! And Paul and I just collapsed. It was terrifying. It was like God coming down to see what you were up to.
About four numbers in, we'd start to flash the audience with these light beams. Up until then, you couldn't see anybody. So in the fourth number, we were flashing the audience, and I looked up, and at the front of the balcony, there was four Kraftwerk guys looking at us like this. And I panicked, I fell off my keyboard, I've got the wrong notes. And I was trying to look over to Andy going, "Look, look, it's Kraftwerk."
All I remember was spending the entirety of that concert gazing up at these black-clad figures on the balcony, wondering, "I wonder what they're thinking, I wonder what they're thinking. Oh, God, I wonder what they're thinking." That's all I can remember.
It was great. We met them after. I think we had dinner or something. We met them after and definitely had some drinks together anyway. But I just remember when they came backstage to meet them, it was just like meeting God, really.
Classic meet your heroes, don't know what to say, put your foot in the mouth style. All I could think of to ask Ralph Hutter was, "What kind of speakers do you have in your studio?" Duh! Couldn't you think of anything more interesting than that?
25 years on, and Andy and Paul are back in Germany. And in the audience tonight, Kraftwerk. But before the performance can begin, there are contractual duties to perform.
Where's Michael gone? Oh, there he is.
So, may I introduce you to the managing director from the venue, as well as the ice hockey president and stuff like that. We are the first big production to be hosted here. So, the Metro Stars are the ice hockey team of the house. Come here. I know the ice hockey shirt. Andy McCluskey. No.
Spelt right. Can you believe it? Are you getting this? Freebies. Free merchandising. Don't have to get that. You're going to wear it on stage, mate?
I think it'll drown me. Can you
piece for the Wicked TV interview.
Oh no! Backstage sind wir jetzt hier, und zwar in der Umkleide von OMD, Orchestral Manoeuvres in the Dark. Highness.
We've done 10.
10, yeah.
This is 11.
This will be 11.
And I think we've got the hang of it by now. Just.
Take us back to day one.
Day one in Hamburg was one of the most frightening experiences of my life, actually.
We were pooing ourselves, basically.
It's
It was compounded for me because I was still carrying infections, which has turned out to be a chronic sinus virus, which I've had for anything between 4 months and 2 years, I'm now told, by the doctor who x-rayed me. So not only were we just first night nerves, but I was nursing a bad throat. So it took us probably, I would say, Hanover. The third gig was where it finally kind of like, we went like, oh, this is what we do. We're on stage. Okay, I remember now.
You must have spent a lot of time together, you two, for the first time in a long time. Would I be right in saying that?
Yeah, we have really, yeah.
Got on really well?
Yeah, we haven't had any moments where we need to strangle each other, have we?
Speak for yourself.
No.
This, in every sense, this has been a nice sort of gentle reintroduction to touring. You know, we're only doing 12 minutes a night.
It's not exactly taxing, that bit.
We're not travelling too far. We're not, you know, completely stuck with each other in a bus for 8 hours a day. It's a nice way back in. And I think it's kind of whetted our appetite for next year.
Manoeuvres in the dark.
Architecture and morality left Orchestral Manoeuvres in the dark on a permanent high. They were now being urged to cash in on a popular appeal that was taking them further away from their musical roots. They retreated to the gramophone suite once again for another crack at confounding fans and critics alike and keeping excitable Virgin Records executives guessing.
Everyone around us said, OK, well, your next album, this is such a success, you know, you've sold 3-4 million copies, whatever it was. This was such a success, you just do the next Architecture and Morality now and you'll be as big as Pink Floyd and you'll be rich. And so we thought, right, OK, well, that's not what we're going to do then. We're going to do something completely different.
And, after all, defying expectations had always worked before.
We were flying by the seat of our pants, and it was quite scary. And I was a terribly, terribly intense and painful young man. I don't know how people put up with me. And if I could get hold of the young Andy McCluskey when he was 21, I'd smack him around the head and say, for Christ's sake, look up, enjoy it, smell the roses, because it ain't gonna last, mate. You've only got, you know, 3 or 4 years at this peak moment. Then it's gonna become a roller coaster. You'll have more good moments, but a lot of bad ones. But right now, you are the king of the bloody hill. You guys are doing something that you dreamt of doing. Why are you not enjoying it? You're writing songs on your terms that don't sound like anybody else's, and they're selling millions.
Dazzle Ships didn't sell millions. Having never wanted success, OMD suddenly found that they couldn't live without it, and the album's failure jolted Andy and Paul out of their arrogance and into the more cynical world of writing hit songs to make money.
After the sort of, not artistic disaster of Dazzle Ships, but financial disaster of Dazzle Ships, it really scared us because we, you know, we did have mortgages and we did have financial responsibilities now. And so that was the first time we realised after Dazzle Ships that we needed to write a hit album. Everyone was saying it, our management was saying it, the record company was saying it, the rest of the band were saying it, our crew were saying it. Everyone was saying, you've got to write a hit album. And that pressure was enormous on Andy and I.
They rose to the challenge with a string of profitable albums in the mid-1980s that appealed to a broader church. But they were working hard for their success with a continuous cycle of writing, recording, touring and promoting, now taking in the United States. The stresses and strains put pressure on their writing and on their relationship. Something had to give.
I think as the 80s progressed and we hit a wall commercially with some of the tracks and we started to realise that when we'd been selling millions, we'd only be earning pennies. And it became a little bit more like a job once we started to think about, oh God, we've got to write hits because that's how we stay alive. And perhaps we lost some of the pure artistic, in inverted commas, endeavour. There was a gradual drift, which culminated in 1989 in us deciding that we didn't want to do it anymore.
Seventeen years on, and a rehearsal room is the venue for a very special reunion. Andy, Paul, Mal and Martin are about to take to the road once again. A summer of sell-out concerts and festival appearances begin with an exclusive gig in front of 100 lucky fans.
What we're doing tonight is we're just going to have a quick warm-up, really, you know, our first sort of... I mean, see, Andy and I have been playing in front of audiences. We did the German tour with the orchestra, but Malcolm Martin haven't played in front of an audience for quite a long time now, so... Well, in fact, 17 years, if we're going to be precise, so...
We thought it would be the safe option to do, really, before we go into production rehearsals and take on our first gig, to actually try and run through the set non-stop with an actual audience, but hopefully a forgiving one, because they've all been invited through our official website.
Obviously, seeing the email, I jumped at the opportunity, you know, to come and see them and to get an extra ticket for my fiancé. It was fantastic, and I want to get in there, you know, and just to hear them live, it's fantastic.
I'm looking forward to seeing them at an intimate gig. I've seen them, you know, big concerts, Liverpool Empire, stuff like that. So, small, low-key gig like this, very exciting.
Fan, long time. Best music we ever heard in the 80s. Absolutely superb that they've got together again for this tour. And we're really looking forward to tonight.
And I've been a fan of them. A fan of the band for many years, but I never thought I'd actually come back to see this moment again. No, I thought this was all done and dusted, but now it's back in the forefront again.
It's going to do ton of time for half an hour to go, yeah? So,
it's almost exactly 2 years ago that we decided to actually get together and do this again, so it's been a long time coming, and there were times when it seemed like it would never happen.
The timing was never right whenever we discussed doing OMD again. Andy was always too busy, or I was too busy. So, to the fact that we managed to do it is quite a feat, really, I think.
I think it's been frustrating, exciting, a lot of bloody hard work, but I think we wisely started early so that we've been able to give ourselves the time to get prepared, because there was so much preparation to do. You know, we were starting essentially from scratch. We had no keyboards with the right sounds, we had no backing with the right sounds, we had to relearn who we used to be, basically, which has taken time, but I think we're there.
Isn't there? There's a lot of people now that are coming out again, and I don't think it's for the money, it's just a case that there are people out there that still want to hear their music.
It's a music that really you can't put your finger on what attracts you. I think Andy's always said that it's music that you whistle at bus stops, and he's absolutely spot on when he says that.
It was the first band I saw live in 1981 on this tour, actually, the Architecture and Morality tour, so it was a Birmingham Odeon. And I mean, sadly, I still have the programme, so I thought I'd bring it in case anyone wanted to look at it. I'm not going to get it signed, I promise.
What is it about them that you like so much?
Andy McCluskey's dancing. Gotta be, gotta be.
When we did decide to do it, you know, would there be any interest? You know, would people want to come and see us? Would the tickets sell for these shows? Because we were quite adventurous in the size of venues that we chose, and we were pretty worried about that, really, because we don't want to play to, you know, quarter-empty halls, because they're big places. But, you know, the response has been fantastic from the fans, so there's definitely still a market for OMD out there.
I'm optimistic that this is going to be a good period. I think we're doing it for the right reasons. We're enjoying it so far. And I'm hoping that the tour we're about to undertake will be the beginning of a new chapter that I suppose we didn't think would ever happen. We thought the book was closed. So we better make sure that it's a good chapter to read.
Concert's ever been in this town, and boy did they look like they didn't know what to do in the first half. Yeah, there's a certain format to it, you know, where they
basically don't stand on ceremony. So fortunately they've had two and a half hours of other people teaching them that they can have fun, so we'll go out there and die a death.
But you can always rely on Kraftwerk to start a Mexican wave when you're
I'm hoping they're going to be bloody congering down the front of the stage.
Trans Europa
Conga.
Trans Europa Conga.
It certainly made a difference when the orchestra arrived, didn't it? Because we were just playing with the band to begin with.
Yeah, it was a bit... Come in with my keks off, I don't
know. Paul needed to go out to a longer answer then. So.
Yeah. What key is it on? We're almost in.
One.
I'll have to listen to the record now for practice.
Yeah,
from there. And it looks like, you know, you're absolutely, definitely not focused on me.
That really is idiot-proof, isn't it?
It is.
even you can film with that. I didn't change the world. I didn't, you know, create world peace or invent a, you know, a medicine that saved millions of people. You know, we just made some music that, for however long it lasted, be it 3 minutes or whatever, was an important and influential part of somebody's life and somebody's history and somebody's mind. And that, in its own way, is incredibly rewarding.